here what we see is as time goes by, how is my loss changing, the loss in accuracy, meaning training loss in accuracy, and how is my validation loss in accuracy changing. So the blue and the green lines here, I hope you can see the difference, are losses. So as you can see, they're both going down, but of course the training loss is getting lower faster, and for the validation loss, after a while it starts getting lower a little bit slower, whereas for accuracy we have more or less the same thing. Training accuracy goes quicker towards the end, gets higher quicker towards the end, whereas the validation accuracy kind of gets a little bit better, but it's not groundbreaking. This is what I expected. If there was overfitting, what we would see is the accuracy of the training would get higher and higher, whereas the accuracy of validation would stay more or less the same. So it's good that we do not have overfitting on this one. If you want to refresh your model and start training from scratch, you need to go to this little cell and run it again. So the model will be set to kind of empty model again from the beginning, and then you can train it again. But if you just compile or just do this again, it's going to train the model on the model that's already been trained. So the weights are going to be updated on their already trained state. So that's just a difference that you might want to keep an eye out for. Then we have this nifty little function that will tell us how our model is doing on the test set. So we see that our model's loss is 0.07. So that's pretty good. And the accuracy is 0.98. I guess it could be even better if we change some parameters. And I'll actually really encourage you to either use this data set or the other data set that I mentioned, the fashion MNIST data set, and see if you can get a better accuracy by changing some of the hyperparameters, changing, adding a hidden layer, for example, increasing the neurons in the hidden layer, and maybe changing the activation functions. Well, I mean, these ones are actually pretty good. Maybe we'll do that more in the upcoming exercises, but kind of tweak a little bit and see if you can surpass this one. You know, I think that could be a fun exercise to do. The last thing that I want to do is I want to get predictions for the test set. So what is done? Maybe I should show you this one by one. So if I say model predict things for the in the test set inputs, it's going to look like this. So it looks like a big mess. What it shows us is this is an array that has a length of 10, and it is showing me what possibility or probability it gives for each of the classes. So this is the probability of the first example in the test set to be 0, to be 1, to be 2, etc., etc. But of course, this is not really useful to see. What I want to see is just tell me what number it is you think that it is. So then you can use the argmax function, and then it will tell us what number it thinks it is. So then it will tell me, okay, 7 was the highest probability, 2 was the highest probability, 1 was the highest probability, etc. And one nice thing we can do with this is we can look at confusion matrix to see which number was confused with which number the most. So I'm just going to come up with or calculate a confusion matrix using the TensorFlow's confusion matrix function. And I'm going to try to visualize it, but we're missing the module seaborn. Okay, after I install seaborn, I can actually look at my plot. And what we do here is we are using seaborn. Seaborn is kind of like, you can use matplotlib too, but it's kind of has nicer looking graphics. It has nicer colors, and that's why people tend to use it. Heat map is a really useful one. So heat map, what heat map does is if it's lower, you see there is like a map here, what everything corresponds to. For, you can change this color scheme, of course, but we're using the greens color scheme. And for numbers that are lower, it's going to show me a brighter green. For numbers that are higher, it's going to show me a really dark green. And everything else I do here is just setting the titles, setting the axis labels, etc., etc. And here you can see that we actually have a really nice diagonal line here showing that most of the zeros were as classified as zeros, most of the ones were classified as ones. And, you know, if there was like a really dark colored green here, then we would know, okay, twos have been confused with eights. But it actually looks pretty good. I guess the highest number is this one, whereas threes and fives are being confused with each other, which I think makes sense. So when you're handwriting threes and fives, they might look like each other. But this is, I think, a good example to see. All right, as I said, I would really encourage you to go and do the same exercise with a different data set that you find here. It would be even better if you try to do it with something very different, but I would just suggest you go do it with Fashion MNIST dataset. And on top of that exercise, it will be very interesting to see if you can tweak the hyperparameters a little bit to get, or maybe, you know, increase the epoch size, increase or decrease the batch size, etc., to see if you can get a better test performance. And you can, even if you do that, please share with us, or even if you can surpass it, maybe share with us still in the comment section below and tell me what accuracy, what loss you achieved. And after you're done with that, we can continue with our lessons. And in the next module, we're going to be talking about in more detail the main problems with neural networks and how the state-of-the-art solutions for those are. And, you know, we're going to be going into deep details of how to select a loss function, an optimizer, how to divide the validation data, etc., about the batch size. So it will be a very interesting module. It's going to be quite theoretical, but after that, we're going to build a much more sophisticated neural network. So that's going to be exciting. So hope to see you there and enjoy the exercise.